able to please share me what exactly you do, Emily?
Okay, what I do, I actually used to be a quality assurance analyst. So what I would do, I would then listen to calls and verify if those calls were authentic sales for like your, you know, your companies where they do cell phone contracts, insurance, and things like that. So that's what I used to do. But okay. Right now, I'm actually running my own business. And a lot of people don't see it as a business. But for me, it is run exactly as a business because it's a non-profit organization. So, you know, having to give back to the community is something that I've done, I think, most of my teenage years and up to my early adult years. And yeah, so basically I'm a founder of a non-profit organization called Phoenix Alexandra, and I also do motivational talks for people in corporate and any other setting that feel they need to have a guest speaker or keynote speaker. That's what I do.
Okay, no, that's interesting. So in your NPO, what exactly do you do there? How do you help these people?
Okay, our NPO does a lot of you know, activities that are art related, because as well I have a background in the arts industry where I am a professional dancer. So they do dancing, spelling bee, reading. We have a reading club. We also have where the young children get to do acting and drama. So those are the things that we are currently doing at in the NPO.
All right. No, that's interesting. So which means you guys actually have sponsors for all your activities.
Yes, we'd love to partner. For me, it's more of I would love partnership more than sponsors, because you know, sponsors, they give once off and then that's it. With us, we would like partnership, because we know it's an ongoing thing and the children are most likely to be interested in the different fields, because arts, for example, for me, has given me discipline. And that's why I've started it, so that I can show young kids that, and parents, that it's not only academics that can get you far, but also the arts can also get you far.
Yes. No, that's beautiful. That's beautiful. So when did you get started with this NPO?
Funny enough, we actually started during COVID, you know, the I think it was the second lockdown, because the first lockdown was in March, and then the second lockdown happened, and now what happened was I saw a gap between my nieces and nephews. They were bored, so I started teaching them how to dance and different dance styles, and then their friends started getting involved, and it started off like that.
Okay. No, that's quite interesting, actually. That's quite interesting. So since you get started, have you ever been having partners or sponsors, or you are funding everything by yourself?
Okay, at the moment, I have the support of the parents, meaning that if when they can, they contribute financially. But however, everything is on me. And then we've had now in the month of June, it was such a beautiful month for us, because we got a total library from AFBOC, because I think it was one of the parents that applied, or somebody applied on our behalf, to say that we have a reading club and we're in need of books. So AFBOP had donated us a a trolley worth 50,000 with 500 books.
Okay.
So, and then again in the same month of June, Pep gave us a voucher, 5,000 rand, and we were able to buy the kids clothing so that they, so it's easier on the parents, and then they don't have to buy them a certain uniform for whenever they're going out to perform, because we also do like live performances with the kids, helps with their confidence and helps with them getting exposed to different worlds outside of Alexandra Township, because most of them were born here and have never gone out of the township and don't know other settings. So meaning that this is not just about, you know, teaching them discipline and dancing and all of these other activities, but it's also giving them an experience that they've never had and probably would have never had if they were not part of Phoenix.
Yes. Okay, no, that's beautiful. So do you have any challenges you have been facing since we got started? What can you say have been some of your biggest challenge?
Okay, my biggest challenge has to be the teenagers. Mm. I kid you not, teenagers are one thing, and teenagers are really just on another level of you can't tell me what to do. And because I'm not far off, you know, in terms of age with them, it was really a challenge. But I really had to, you know, remove myself from being the adult and try to be on their level and understand why are they resisting, you know, rules, why are they resisting certain things that are in place. And I guess some of them decided to leave, which is a, you know, it's a personal choice. You cannot force someone to do something they don't want to do. So that's what I had to learn, which is the hard way, because I wanted all of these kids to pursue and to be great. And unfortunately, because of such attitudes, and also because some parents don't understand what we are doing, you know, you go to your parent and say, I'm having a problem with your daughter because of attitude, you know, what is going on? Please help me, let's work together. And they would tell you it's none of your business. So, you know, it's really one of the challenges and many challenges that I face, that sometimes when you're trying to, you know, discipline or just show them a path that is a better for them, because they are kids at the end of the day, you get resistance. So that's basically the only challenge that sticks out to me. And the other challenge would be that we don't have space at the moment. So everything, we are operating just outside my house, but it's fine, you know, God will make a way. And I believe that someday, somewhere we'll have a center where these kids can come, and we'll create that safe space, because that's what we're trying to create.
All right. No, that's beautiful. Okay, so let's go to the motivation side of your business. Which exactly do you speak for in terms of companies, gatherings? Are you industry specific?
Pardon?
Are you industry specific in your speaking career, the motivation side?
No, we're not. Industry, in terms of industry, I'm really not specific in terms of, you know, the work that I do with the kids. Any company that is willing to come on board and, you know, partner with us, I think I'm a creative person, you know, coming from a creative background as well, we will work out something that will be beneficial for both that company and Phoenix, because at the end of the day, I feel like me giving these children as many opportunities as possible is the best thing that I could ever do, because I was also given an opportunity once when I was younger. So, yeah.
Yes. All right. Okay. So I just want to know a little bit more about the motivation side of your business. Like, when did you get started with that career?
Okay, with my motivational speaking career,
Yes.
it started way back in high school. When I actually traced it back, I started when I was 16 in high school, and then because I had a fear of speaking in public. I think a lot of people have that fear, so I had the same fear. But then I was like, I have a story to tell, and I think I'm a very positive person. I should share that positivity with people. And then I started. And then when I was 18, got introduced to an international program called the Duke of Edinburgh International Award,
Okay.
which then also helped boost my confidence. And then, from there, I can say the rest is history, because I've done talks for companies like AFBOB. I've done talks for companies like like Standard Bank and so forth. So
Okay.
I cannot say that it's something that I fear now. It's something that I enjoy. Yeah.
Okay, no, that's beautiful. And any challenges you are facing that side so far?
Yeah, there is challenges. I mean, you get an inquiry. A person would send you an email to say, "Look, I'm looking for a keynote speaker. Please come through." And then people would want you to do it for free, and
Yes.
you'd be like, "But I need to get there using transport. I need to get there, doing so and so." It was easier when I had a 9-to-5 job, which was the quality assurance analyst job that I had, because then I wouldn't charge as much as the I wouldn't charge as most times. I would just do it because of the love of it. But now that
Yes.
I have a non-profit organization that I need to focus on, and also, I have to pay my own bills, I'm charging. And now people are like, "Hey, and I'm like, "But I'm still affordable." There are people that charge a lot of money for what I do.
Yeah.
So I think that is the only thing that people expect me to still do it for free, or want such services for free. That would be the only challenge that I'm facing at the moment.
Okay, no, that one is the biggest challenge actually many small businesses face. So I hope you'll be
Yes.
able to overcome it. All right. So what else would you like
No,
to share?
I'm very positive that I will overcome.
All right. What else would you like to share that maybe you think I did not think about? Do you have any
I
advice
would
that you want to
really
share?
like to share, I think, okay. I think one thing that I would like to share with the audience or people listening is that, regardless of your personal, issues and struggles, we all have power within ourselves. And I think a lot of people might not know, I'm living with a disability,
Okay.
diagnosed with cerebral palsy. And the doctors at a young age told me I would never speak. I'd never
Wow.
be able to speak. I'd never be able to walk. But I'm doing the opposite of what they said. And you need to believe in yourself before everybody else can start believing in you. It
Yes.
starts with you. So basically, even when I started this nonprofit organization, I didn't have a plan, but because I believed in what I was doing, it's working out now.
Okay, beautiful, beautiful. It was so where can our audience be able to learn more about what you do, Emily? If someone wants to contact you or to learn more about your work, how do they reach you?
It's very simple. I'm on all the social media platforms, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, LinkedIn, and that's how we actually linked up. And also with the nonprofit organization, they're all on the platforms. The only person platform that I'm not on personally is TikTok. So on Facebook, I'm Nkateko Emily Mabasa, my full name.
Okay.
And on Instagram, I'm Nkati, which is spelled Nkati underscore Mabasa. That's my surname. And then on Twitter, I'm just Emily underscore Mabasa. That's where they will find me on LinkedIn, I'm also just Nkateko Emily Mabasa, just like that. And when they follow me, then it's easier for them to just follow my nonprofit organization. But on all the platforms for my non-organization is Gomorrah Has Risen, because Alexandra also has a nickname, which is dubbed Gomorrah. So,
okay.
And a lot of people say that Gomorrah has a bad name, a bad, past to it. But I say, whoever you are and whatever you're going through, you embrace the bad and the good. You can always turn the bad into good. So that's why that's our tagline, Gomorrah Has Risen. And
okay.
That's where they can find us on all the social media platforms.
Okay. No, that's beautiful, Emily. Thank you so much for joining me this morning.
Thank you so much for the opportunity to share my story. And I hope that your audience have enjoyed and obviously learned a thing or two.
Obviously, of course, yes.